if you're gonna be a narcissist, at least have hands. Like, you can't you can't be a punk ass and then wanna be mad.
Hi, and welcome to Normal Gossip. I'm Kelsey McKinney. In each episode of this podcast, we're going to bring you an anonymous morsel of gossip from the real world. Today, I have with me Laci Mosley, actor, comedian, and host of the Scam Goddess podcast. She's also in season 2 of iCarly, which is now streaming on Paramount Plus. Laci, hello, what's up?
Woo, chat. I'm good. I literally ran in here from the nail salon, but before that, I was at the gun range.
I was going to say your nails look incredible, and knowing that you had been at the gun range, I was like, how did you manage this?
I got them done after, you know, go get the gunpowder off my hands, you know, as one does. But yeah, I'm good. How are you, Kelsey?
I'm good. You know, just excited to do a little gossiping on this Friday afternoon. I think we're going to have some fun.
Yes.
We at Normal Gossip are big fans of the Scam Goddess podcast. And we're always, thank you. Alex and I, the producer, are always getting in trouble because we are like, oh, this is perfect. We'll listen to it at the gym. And then it's like you're midway through a squat, like trying not to laugh. So we do blame you for that.
I'm so sorry. That could be a dangerous situation.
Thank you.
Especially if there's some cuties around. Don't mess around and fart. Then you're going to have to blame it on somebody.
Laci, tell me, what's your relationship with gossip?
My relationship with gossip is I firmly subscribe to the very popular phrase, if you don't have anything nice to say, then come sit by me so we can talk.
You know? Like, yeah, you and me both.
There's nothing worse than when you're trying to spill some tea or you're trying to be like, this bitch. And then the person you're talking to is like, well, I think they're really nice, or, oh, you shouldn't be that way. I'm like, can you please be negative with me? The fuck? All right, anyways, I'm leaving. Like, I'm not, like, negative all the time, but if I want to spill some tea or if I have some gossip, like, come on now. Get into the cheese, man.
Yeah, what's the point in talking to people if they're not going to play with you?
Right.
What are you even doing here?
Also, when people do the holier than thou thing, I'm like, you got something to hide. You telling me you a whole saint, you don't ever talk about it. You don't ever fix your list to talk about nobody. Like, okay.
I'm also like, am I on your list? Right? Like, if you're telling me like, oh, I'm not going to shit talk with you, I'm like, is that because you've aligned with everyone else against me?
Yes. I go there too, because I'm like, if you're not going to give some tea as well, then I think you're the bone carrier. You're just going to hear what I have to say, and then you can go share the business. Like, the
bone carrier.
Mm-hmm. So we call it from Real Housewives of Atlanta, the bone carrier. Like, you just over here, the bone collector, just over here bringing all the bones.
Did you, like, grow up with any associations with gossip? Like, what was your family relationship like with it?
Oh, yeah. My family loves to gossip. Their favorite thing to do. Honestly, low-key destroyed many relationships because they love to gossip. And it's like the rumor mill in my family, because it's such a large family, shit takes so long to get to everybody that by the time you get it, like, telephone, that shit is so distorted. You're like, what? Like,
do you confirm? Like, how do you deal with a gossip that's gone through that many telephones in your own family? Because you're going to have to see these people, right?
Yeah, you have to kind of reroute to the source or get the two people who are being gossiped about in the same room to get the real story. Because there was a time that, I'm not going to be specific because people will be in my business.
Yes.
But a family member of mine accused another family member of trying to set up her husband with another woman.
Oh,
and
no.
This was simply not true. It was that the family member had a homegirl who had two extra tickets to a Cowboys game.
Oh.
And the you know, family member who didn't do anything wrong was like, oh, do you want to go with me to this game? And my homegirl has two extra tickets because I know you're a huge Cowboys fan. So they all go to the game, and somehow this gets misconstrued. Mind you, the wife and the family member who invited the husband have been friends for as long as I've been alive.
What?
And related by marriage. And
oh my God.
It didn't even matter. The wife didn't call the other family member. The wife didn't even, like, ask. Like, they just let it run around the mill until it got to basically, like, this person was trying to hook these people up and, I don't know, be a cuckold but for family.
I feel bad for the person who gave him these tickets. Like, those are expensive. Like, Cowboys tickets are expensive. So I assume this person was like, oh, I'm doing this fun thing. We're all just going to go to the Cowboys game. And now you've created a massive tsunami of drama.
I also think that the family member who got the ticket, who loves Cowboys, must have been doing something in his phone, and then when the wife saw, immediately scapegoated the other family member and was like,
"Oh, mm-hmm."
And it wasn't the friend who the trifling family member was speaking with. I think he was just trying to be like, "Look over there."
It was them,
right? And it worked.
How many layers of people did this go through before you got it?
Oh, it took years. Because it's crazy. It took years until one of my cousins gave me the tea, and then I gave the family member the tea of why they hadn't been speaking to the wife. Because they were like, I haven't talked to the wife in forever, and I don't understand what's going on. I know the wife is also a Facebook conspiracy theorist, like damn near incredible. Aluminum foil. So yeah. It's like, oh, maybe this person's just off the grid. Not having an idea what happened. Just off the grid. Until my cousin told me, now this is what I heard from my other cousin. And I was like, oh, damn. And then I told the family member who had invited the other one to the Cowboys game. And they were like, what?
I get so jealous of this because my family is like super small, and also none of the drama is fun, right? Like it's like I have like four cousins total.
Oh girl, I got the good drama on both sides. Tyler Perry could never.
Yeah, so see, I want to go to your family reunion because my family reunion is just like a sad dinner, like 10 people, right? Like there's no good drama. I'm not getting any telephone calls.
Oh no, every family reunion that we've ever had, there's always a relative who shows up and they're like, hey y'all, this is your cousin. And we're like, every time we do this?
Well, one thing we've been talking a lot about on this podcast is like some people have a really specific definition between gossip and being a gossip. Mm-hmm. Do you have this line?
Yes.
Tell me. Lay it on me.
I am not a gossip.
Okay.
My friend,
even though you're like, come over, sit by me and tell me.
And tell me. But I'm likely to either forget or it's going to be something so far removed from me. Or if it's close to me. Okay, you know what? I'll say I am a gossip, but I'm not gossipy. I'm not messy. So if you tell me some tea, then I'm not going to tell anybody that it would get back to you with. Yeah. Like, if you give me some tea, I'm going to call my best friend JoJo in Jersey, who has no affiliation with people in Los Angeles. And I'm be like, JoJo girl, let me tell you what I heard today. But I'm not going to talk to anybody in our circles. I'm not going to allow your business or your mess to reach people that it actually could affect you by. You know, you have to have a good gossip friend who's completely removed from all aspects of your immediate life.
Yes. For me, that person is my sister. I'm like, girl, I've got some information for you. You live in a totally different part of the country. You have no idea who these people are. Let me catch you up. Like, we're going through it all.
We all need an outlet for gossip. It's just when you're a messy gossip, then you're telling everybody who will listen. You're like, hey, sis, you got ears? Oh, you do American Sign? Hold on. I still got you. Like, I feel like messy gossips learn several languages so that they can tell any and everybody that they meet.
Would you like to hear some gossip?
I would love to hear some gossip.
Low stakes, high drama.
Yes.
Okay, here we go. I'm gonna set a scene first. You're gonna either love it or hate it, possibly both.
Ooh, okay, set the stage. Okay, very Shakespearean.
Okay, so what we have are 15 sorority sisters. So one of the weird sorority traditions that this one has is that when you are in your little pledge class, you get a like silk handkerchief, right? This like nice big handkerchief. Okay. And then it's just one per pledge class. And then because sororities are often, you know, obsessed with the idea of heterosexual marriage, whenever you get married and obviously don't keep your name, your new initials get embroidered onto the handkerchief.
Oh no.
Mm-hmm. go ahead.
This is such a gaslighty thing, because then it's like, you know, when sororities are really focused on getting married and stuff, that becomes a competition. You know, you try to get your MRS, so now y'all looking at the silk cloth like, oh, well, I just sewed my name. No.
Yeah, so that's exactly where this is going, as you've envisioned. the handkerchief is very important, and it's, like, important enough that, like, at some point someone got divorced and they, like, took it to a professional to have her initials, like, unstitched.
That's petty.
Mm-hmm. Petty as hell. These girls are, like, upset. They love all their, like, little sister, quote-unquote sister traditions, right? Which is cute, I guess. But because they're from a big Southern university, most of them got married, like, right out of school. So they were like, oh, I got my BA. I also got this MRS degree immediately. Mm-hmm. My initials are going on the handkerchief. I'm done. And because they had this, like, weird connectedness and kind of, like, very close group, they were all in each other's weddings.
Oh, and it's 15 of them.
15 of them.
Are you kidding me? That's a lot of weddings to go to. And weddings?
They're not cheap.
Here's my thing about weddings. If you want to ball out with your wedding, have a GoFundMe.
Yes.
Get on Instagram. Start begging with your Cash App. I don't know. Pick up a side hustle. Drive for Uber Eats. But don't you fucking dare have no damn wedding where I gotta be a bridesmaid. And you like, okay, so we all getting matching swimsuits. Mm-hmm, we all gotta pay for your bridesmaid dresses. Everybody gotta be in a Jimmy Choo heel. Like, don't try to ball out on my fucking dime. Don't try to have, we having a bachelorette party. Y'all got money for bottle service? Wonderful. Like, don't try to ball out on my dime. If you're broke, let's go to the courthouses and I will get a smooth Zara number for you and we can clap it up and throw some roses at your feet, bitch. Don't try to be rich on my money. Sorry, that obviously that comes from a very personal space.
I agree with you. I have bought too many very unflattering taffeta dresses in my day to ever allow bridesmaid experience to come for me and my family again.
Right. I'm just saying, if you live in an apartment and the stairs to the apartment are outside, don't register at Tiffany's. Like, just know your lane.
None of these girls know their lane. Okay,
wonderful.
So there are 15 of them. 13 of them get married within, like, the first 3 years out of college. That's just, like, boom, 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 boom. Immediately. So the two girls that are left, as you can imagine, bond. Because they're like, we've had to be in 13 weddings. Our initials are not on the handkerchief, which now only has, like, a 2-inch by 2-inch space left for us. We're, like, gonna, you know, we're gonna bitch together. Because we're the ones that are, like, left.
Yes.
Right? Before we continue this, I'm going to steal from you what you do. Can I have a name for our main character?
Absolutely. Her name is absolutely going to be, her name is Amanda.
Amanda. Incredible name. Okay, so we have Amanda, who is our main character, and then we have the other last girl who's left is named Meredith. Okay, so it's the two of them. They've become very close. They're the last ones to get married. Whatever. They go for about 5 years, and Amanda gets a boyfriend in the fall of 2018. She's like, I really like my boyfriend. We're taking it slow.
How dare she?
A little bit, how dare she? But she's like, you know what? I'm going to be really careful not to, like, hurt Meredith's feelings, right? I want to try and, like, make sure that our friendship is maintained. This obviously does not really work, because every time she sees Meredith, it becomes, like, more and more awkward. And Amanda tells herself, she's like, oh, well, she's just, like, a little jealous. But the way that relationships work and time works, eventually she'll have a boyfriend, too, and it'll balance out.
No. I am on Meredith's side so far because, Amanda, we all know what happens when you commiserating with your single bitch. And y'all like, man, fuck these men. Fuck Hinge. I'm tired of getting all bumbling and having to come up with a prompt and start the conversation. I'm sick of this shit. Y'all at the bar. Y'all doing shots. Y'all going out. Now all of a sudden, Amanda, she can only go to dinner at 6 o'clock. And then when Meredith wants to go hit a bar, try to meet people, she's like, well, I have to get home to Jake because, like,
exactly,
we have to cuddle every single night and I can't be away from him.
Yes. So Meredith is miserable. Amanda thinks that she's like, I just think this is her problem.
Wow. She's like,
I don't think this is, like, I think she'll come around. I think it'll work out. I think we can still be close.
Amanda said, put your oxygen mask on first, and then maybe take care of your neighbor.
Sure did. So they started dating, Amanda and her boyfriend started dating, like, the fall of 2018. In January of 2021, Meredith starts dating someone.
Okay. She's in the
game. As you know, And she's in the game. As you know, in the South, the pandemic, like, rules don't really exist. And no. So, like, they were just, you know, they're living their lives as normal. Exactly. And this boy that Meredith meets is, like, on their first date at dinner, I think that you and me are predestined to be together.
Murderer.
Terrifying. So Amanda is like, I don't like it. I think he's shady. This is like got cult vibes to me. And this, she can't say this to Meredith, right? Because Meredith is like already mad at her for the 3 years that she's been in this relationship and like ruining their friendship. And Meredith is also like, I'm happy.
3 years? And and Amanda doesn't have a ring? I thought we were moving at sorority speed. Amanda, girl, you might be one of many.
Yes, good thought. So we're going to keep going. Amanda doesn't feel like great about the fact that Meredith is dating this guy, but also it seems like their like relationship is improving, hers and Meredith's. And so she's like, things are getting better. We're like in each other's lives again. We now get to have these like kind of boring drinks at an earlier hour, like you were saying. We get to go to dinner and like split the tab, right? Whatever. Things get better enough by the spring of 2021 that she calls Meredith when her boyfriend tells her that he's going to take her home to meet his parents.
Okay.
And Meredith is like, I'm so happy for you. This is great. You're going to meet them. Everything's coming up, Amanda, right? She goes with her boyfriend to the like 40th wedding anniversary of his beautiful, rich parents, right?
Okay. So maybe he's waiting because he's like, I want to get married for life. Maybe.
Yes. And I think it's important that to remember that, like, in the middle of them dating would have been the pandemic, right? So there's, like, right. a year when, like, you're not going to get engaged or get married because nobody's going to come.
Right.
Right? Or it will just be drama or, like, get canceled or whatever. So they go up there. It's fine. His family's, like, pretty uptight. They're, like, Ivy League people, you know, like, pearls and shit. Like, all of that stuff. And so Amanda's not, like, making a lot of inroads, but she's, like, doing her best. She comes home with a bunch of gossip, and she's like, I can't wait to see Meredith. I'm going to tell her everything. She meets Meredith for drinks when she gets back, and she's, like, she arrives, and Meredith has already ordered champagne for them to the table.
Uh-oh.
And Amanda's, uh-oh. Like, Amanda's like, oh, my God, she just can't wait to hear about my trip. And so Amanda's telling her all this garbage, right, about, like, how her potential future mother-in-law is, like, a little avoidant of her. How
now
her,
I
like,
have to
futures.
Pause.
Yes,
I have to pause it for 1 second, Kelsey, because if I show up and the homegirl, you know, it's at a crisp 4:30 because that's when y'all are meeting now, and the homegirl has a bottle of champagne, my first question is, what are we celebrating? Like, Amanda, how are you going to sit down and start thinking this is about you? Amanda, the narcissism is jumping out. Like, you thought the champagne was so you could spill tea? Sis, we don't get champagne for tea. We get martinis for tea.
Yes, and you don't get, like, the bucket. Like, the ice bucket screams celebration.
And women don't just buy champagne. Well, I do. But most, if they're sorority women, you know, they're not just copping a whole bottle on their own. There's no man in sight. Nobody else is purchasing it for shits and giggles.
Especially not at a restaurant where champagne bottles are, like, super upcharged.
Mm-hmm. Like, y'all could have did it at the Cribbo. Then if you see some champagne and some orange juice, you're like, yeah, let's spill the tea. But delicious. If we're at a restaurant and they don't mark that champagne up, they don't mark that damn LaMarca. They don't mark LaMarca
500%.
500%. Yeah. we're choosing.
Yeah.
So continue.
What are we cheersing? But Amanda, you know, she's just talking excited. About, she's just talking, right? And Meredith is just sitting there the whole time. And Amanda's like, you know, I don't think she's really paying attention to me. Like, I don't think she's, like, listening. And so she's like, you're being weird, right? Like, why aren't you listening? And Meredith is like, I'm being weird because I have something to tell you. And she raises her left hand flat up.
Wow. So she's been sitting with her left hand in between her coochie. Like, just letting it get warm. Just sitting there the whole time. She eating with one hand. She drinking with one hand. Amanda hasn't noticed.
Amanda hasn't noticed. And Meredith is like, I'm engaged.
Wow.
Meredith's been with this guy for 6 months.
I mean, look. Like Sex and the City said, men are like cabs. When the light is on, the light is on. And they're like, you're the one. Let's procreate.
Exactly. So his light was on. They were predestined. She's engaged. And Amanda, to her credit, is thrilled. She's like, you know, I've known you forever. This is something you've always wanted. I'm like, so happy for you. Mm-hmm. Right? She's like, tell me the story. Right? So Meredith tells her the whole story.
It's mm-hmm. not giving congratulations.
It's giving congrats. Exactly. Yes. But she, like, you know, she's like, tell me the whole story. Show me the photos. Do the whole thing. Like, walk me through it. And so Meredith does. But during this time of her, like, telling this long engagement story, she has, like, three more glasses of champagne. Right?
And this is Amanda.
Both of them.
Okay. So the real deal is about to come out. The mm-hmm. the drunk man's sober thoughts.
Uh-huh. So Meredith, our newly engaged friend, leans across the table. And she's like, she puts her, you know, she puts her little hands on Amanda's hands. And she's like, I know it's a little weird that I got engaged first.
Oh, Meredith.
But I hope you won't hold it against me.
Meredith, you were actually, you were on the winning team. You just as bad as Amanda. That's why y'all friends, because both of y'all ain't shit. Like, how dare you? You know she was already telling you that she went home and the Smithers mm-hmm. or the Roosevelt or whoever the fuck her boyfriend
rich ass boyfriend
years,
is. Yep.
Right. Mm-hmm. The Vanderbilts were mean to her. She told you she got Gossip Girl, but she was Dan. Like, why mm-hmm. why would you say that?
Why would you say it? Exactly.
I'm so sorry. Look, I know you are now the loneliest bitch, and I'm currently getting my initial stitch into that mm-hmm. handkerchief. And I can't lie, girl, I'm going to make them big, so you really not going to have a lot of room if you ever get chose. Mm-hmm. How dare she? That's fighting words. Amanda, you got to take that bottle and flip it upside down and break it and use it like shit. Like.
So Amanda does that essentially with words. She's like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, I do want to get married, but, like, I'm not in as big of a rush as you. Like, we've been in this relationship for 3 years. Like, in her head, she's like, I think it's really stupid to get engaged after 6 months. Like, but whatever. Do whatever you want. And Meredith is like, you know, I don't want to fight with you. And she pulls out one of those boxes. You know these boxes. They're, like, shiny. Southern girls have them. She opens it, and it's, like, a bridesmaid proposal box.
Wow.
You know what I'm talking about?
How do you not insult me and then
give me this fucking present?
What a bitch. Mm-hmm. What my kind of bitch? Chaos.
Complete chaos. So Meredith's like, I'm so sorry. Like, I don't want to fight. Will you please just, like, be a bridesmaid at my wedding with all of our 14 other friends? Amanda is like, you know what? Yeah, of course I'll be in your wedding. Like, we've been close pals for the past many years. We've done a lot of, like, bitching and moaning together. Of course I want to be up there with you. Some time goes by. 2 months before the wedding, they go to a bachelorette weekend. Where do you think they go to the bachelorette weekend?
Okay. Top three. I'm going to go Vegas, Tulum. No, they're not giving... Ooh. I don't know if they're giving Tulum energy, but I'm going to leave it in there. And then I'm going to go... I'm going to go Miami.
They go to Nashville.
What the hell?
Mm-hmm. Way worse.
Well, okay, I was wrong. I was using the wrong demographic. I should have said Nashville, Austin, or Palm Springs.
I mean, both of those, all of those choices are correct for a bachelorette party, but the vibes are slightly different, right?
Yes.
Nashville sucks more. There's, like, you're on those, like, you know, little bike things mm-hmm. that you drink on.
Which is terrible. Have you ever done it?
No.
I have. Do you want to exercise while drunk?
No.
No. And also, it's harder than it looks. Like, I felt like I was a Peloton instructor when I was on that damn thing. Because I was underneath looking at everybody's feet. And I was like, come on, like, guys, let's move. Let's hustle. We're wasted. Let's go. Everybody's drunk. Move those feet. Like, knees up, bitch. I see you not moving.
Did it work?
Yes.
Okay.
Very
good.
Intimidating. But it was like, you chose to wear heels. Take them bitches off. Let's go.
It's good to know you can have a backup career.
I'm sure they hated me for that. I'm sure my friends were like, we never, and that was my point, is that we'll never do this again. I hope that all of you had a bad time.
So they do this, right? And so mm-hmm. everyone's drunk and they're going to dinner, right?
They're paddling their way to dinner?
No, after they do the paddling, oh, okay. They're going out to dinner, right? And a lot of these girls have been married for, you know, 5 years at this point, and they are very much... And they have kids, and they're very much like mommy's night out, right? So it's like people are trashed, right? Like, everyone is making a lot of choices. Everyone's having a
bathroom
lot of
bathroom compliments. See, the mm-hmm. beginning of being trash is bathroom compliments.
People are holding each other's face with both hands.
Yes, but you're just so smart and so beautiful. And I've missed you so much, Madison. And, like, I've seen your Instagram post, and when you got that pool, I was like, that pool is so nice. And then it goes downhill from there.
Yes. So by the time they get to dinner, things are going downhill. They're sitting at dinner and another bridesmaid asks Amanda, she's like, tell me the story of how you met this guy. So Amanda's telling the story right here. Here's how we met. We've been together for this long. And someone else is like, do you think he's the one? So Amanda is like, yeah, you know, I do think he's the one, but I don't feel that marriage is like the goal in my life. And oh, I don't know that it's like the first, right? She creates like true chaos. As she says, I think he's the one, she sees Meredith at the head of the table make a face.
Meredith. Hi, this is Maymay Sparks, and I'm a Defector subscriber. I originally became an accomplice because it was the closest I might ever get to being transgressive in my life, but I stay because I believe in supporting great writing, which is what you get from Defector. Plus, they're constantly adding new voices to their rosters and features all the time. If you want to support Defector and get your first month for 99 cents, go to defector.com/normalgossip.
So you're sitting at the table, you've just announced that you think your boyfriend is the one. Your supposed very close friend, Meredith, has now made a face to all of your other close friends. What do you do?
So here's the thing. Misery loves company. And at this moment, Amanda should have realized that she was only with you because y'all were both the spinsters mm-hmm. of the group. And that's the energy that Meredith is giving yep. is like, I'm Queen Bee, and this is finally my moment to look down on someone the way that I've been looked down on. And it sucks because this is the bitch that you was commiserating with. So why are you yep. hanging her ass out to dry? Even though Amanda was all up in her own shit and not even ready to celebrate Meredith's shit in the first place when she sat down at that table with the champagne. So Amanda, first of all you bitches deserve each other because y'all bitches. So nobody
found
right.
their people. Yeah.
You found your tribe. Your tribe is friends that you hang out with and then you go home to your boyfriend or your husband and you talk cash shit about
Jesus
all
Christ.
Of them.
Yeah.
About all of them. I don't do that with my close friends. Maybe one.
No, because you like them. Yes. On the most part, you like them. Like yes. that's why you don't go home and talk shit. So do you call her out though?
See, I am different from Amanda because I understand the sorority dynamic that we want to go 80 pot. We want to, like, I get it. I understand it in my spirit. I grew up, I'm mm-hmm. from Texas. I'm from Frisco, Texas. Yep. I know all these girls. That is not my energy. I'm a straight shooter. And these yeah. women, none of these women are. That's not the language of, you know, certain white women in certain demographics. You know, mm-hmm. they're speaking white womanese to each other. So Amanda, I don't see her straight up calling Meredith out unless she's real lit. I think in Amanda's case here, if she really was about just keeping it real, I would have been like, and I would have done it in a playful tone because I love to say things in a playful tone when people know that I'm serious. Mm-hmm. I'm like, Meredith, why you make that face? We was the single lonely bitches for the longest, and now you done got engaged, and now you want to make mm-hmm. a face. I would have just made it a joke. And then I'm sure all the married women would have laughed at it because they could mm-hmm. be like, oh, look at these spinsters fighting each other.
Oh,
like,
so cute.
So
yeah.
cute. We're all married. We don't have to fight spinsters. So I would have gone playful call out.
So before Amanda can do that, you've forgotten that there are 14 other women here who all think that they're best friends and they're all trashed. Someone else is like, Meredith, what's that face?
Messy!
Why are you yes. making that face?
We love an instigator.
And Meredith is like, you know, I just don't think that it's perfect. Like, I think that if he hasn't proposed after this long, like, he probably never will. And, like, why would he? She's like, you know, they live together. And she, like, you know, she's digging her own hole now. She's like, a guy with that much money just, like, doesn't stay with a girl who's not in his own social class. And, like, I love it for you, and I'm so glad you're happy, but I just don't know that it's going to work out.
She called her poor.
Uh-huh.
She says she's poor and unlovable.
Mm-hmm.
A Meredith! Those are fighting. My bitch, I'm going to put you in your Adam's apple. When you say so, I do, you're going to be like, I do.
So, but Amanda is like a baby. She's not going to pick a physical fight. She, like, has never even had a verbal fight in her whole life. She's from this, like, culture of rich women where you just don't ever say anything. So she's mad as hell, but she doesn't say, she's like, you know what? Whatever. She's like, what does this bitch know about relationships anyway? She's marrying this guy she's known for 6 months. Like, whatever. She tries to talk shit to some other bridesmaids, and they're like, she's just stressed. Meredith's just stressed.
So none of them even came to her aid, which mm-hmm. means they think the same thing.
Yes. So Amanda comes back, and she's like, fuck this. I've got a sour taste in my mouth. I don't want to talk to these women anymore. Like, I don't. I'm checking out. I'll, like, look at the group text, but I'm not going to participate anymore. So 3 weeks before the wedding, ooh, Amanda and her boyfriend go to the mountains. They go on this, like, cute little hiking trip. It's, like, not camping. It's, like, glamping, right? There's, like, a cute little bed. It's got
it's
a great
It's all over
view.
Instagram.
It's all over
Amanda's,
Instagram.
Not Jake's.
Uh-huh. Exactly. And Jake proposes to her. And they're like, you know what? We just want to keep this, like, to us for a few days, right? We're just going to keep it, like, quiet so that we can have a fun rest of our vacation. We'll announce it when we get back, right?
So Amanda's engaged this whole time.
Amanda is now engaged. 3 weeks before the wedding, Amanda is engaged.
So the bachelorette – so I'm trying to get the timeline together.
2 months before the wedding is the bachelorette party.
Okay.
Then we fast forward, like, 4 weeks, and we're now 3 weeks before the wedding.
Mm.
And Amanda gets engaged on this hiking trip.
Sweet, sweet revenge.
She's thrilled,
and she's
right?
Holding
obviously.
It.
She's like, this is the best day of my life. She's keeping it secret. She's like, I can't wait to tell everyone. They come back from their trip. She, like, goes into that little group text, and it's just a picture of this, like, you know, fucking pear-shaped diamond.
Oh, not a pear shape. A pear-shaped diamond does not bode well. A pear-shaped diamond says, I don't know you, woman. I've never met you, woman. Like, oh, but if you got a pear-shaped diamond out there and you like it and that's what you wanted, I'm not...
If you requested it specific.
I'm not insulting you.
Yes.
But if it's a surprise pair, I'm curious.
He didn't ask enough questions, really. She's thrilled. She texts the group. She's like, I'm engaged. Everything's great. Everyone's texting her. Right?
Do we know how big the diamond is? Because he's got a rich family.
It's a big diamond.
It's giving Kim K.?
It's big enough that, like, the other girls in the group text are now, like, self-conscious.
Yes, Samantha.
So she has, like, really pulled something off here.
Go off. You better have a blood diamond on your finger, honey. You better have the deaths of several African children resting on your hand. Ew. Do it to them. Okay.
So she texts them all. Everyone's like, you know, they're texting in the group, but they're also texting her individually, right? To be like, I'm so happy for you, right?
Right.
Then
wait, they're texting individually?
Like, she's texting in the group. She's mm-hmm. like, here's the photo. And those girls are responding in the group.
Okay.
But then they're also texting her and being like, hey, I'm so happy for you. Like, congratulations,
okay.
Right? Perfectly fine, whatever.
Yeah, perfect.
Then the evening after she tells them all, she receives a text from one of the other bridesmaids.
Ooh.
I'm just going to show you the length of this text, and I want you to just, can you?
Yeah, if you
can you see what's happening here?
Oh my God, that's a that's a novel. That's when you get a text and you be like that old tweet saying goes, it's like, I'm sorry for what happened, or I'm really happy for you.
I'm not reading all that shit. Yeah. I'm going to read this text to you. Are you ready?
I am. I am going to say, though,
yes,
to everyone out there, this is a piece of solid advice if you gossip. You don't text nobody no tea.
Uh-uh.
Because
no.
Screenshots are real. iPhones are real. I don't know what's happening in Android country. But you call somebody when you got mess. That way you have plausible deniability. You do not text that much mess, because then a screenshot is, there's too many receipts. anytime I have a business conversation, yes. anytime I have a conversation where
on the phone,
I need to, yeah, it's always on the phone mm-hmm. unless it's something that I need documented, and then it is an email or text. So if don't text your mess.
And great evidence for this is that this drama is five tiers of friends removed from me, and I have a screenshot of this text.
Exactly.
On my y'all phone. See, right?
Your text gonna end up on the podcast.
They're all gonna end up in my inbox.
Is that what you want? You want your text to end up on a very successful podcast?
You don't. We have paraphrased this text, but the heart of it is alive and well. I'm going to read it to you. Ready?
Yes.
This comes from another bridesmaid. I am so, so excited for you and Jake. I'm thrilled that you could share such wonderful news with me. I know this has been a long and arduous journey for y'all.
Arduous!
And I can't wait to see it come to your fruition. Also, babe, you're going to be a stunning bride. Here we go.
This woman is a bitch too. Not arduous. I know it's been a long, rocky, terrible, frightening, unsure road where you didn't think you were going to get chose because you was lonely as fuck. And
we're all as surprised as you are.
We can't believe anybody loves you, but we're happy that they do. And you're going to be cute. Anyways.
Mm-hmm. Now we got a paragraph break.
Ooh,
next paragraph.
Oh, not just the annotations.
Uh-huh. Okay. I'm so proud to know you. It requires such a level of selflessness and care for Meredith to keep this news secret until after her wedding. I can barely imagine how Meredith would feel if this wonderful news and that huge, beautiful ring became the focus of her special day. I know that you would never want to take attention away from her, and you and I both know that when people see your engagement ring, they are going to flip, in all caps. They are going to be just so, so happy and want to congratulate you and focus on you. Paragraph break. Meredith is unbelievably blessed to have you. I just feel really bad for her right now because she told me that she feels like things are really tense between y'all and that this drama is really wearing on her. She would be heartbroken if her special weekend became about your engagement. Love you the most. Can't wait to see you in 2 short weeks. Go. Let it out.
So, one, whoever sent this text to Amanda is more Meredith's friend than she is Amanda's friend.
Yes. This is now your enemy, in my opinion.
This is your enemy. And also, Meredith, if you want to send shots, sweetie, you better be the shooter. Mm-hmm. Like, why are you sending your minions to do your duty? Third, the comment on the size of the ring. So the girls have obviously opened another group
channel.
Chat,
mm-hmm.
and it's only got 14 people in it, and Amanda, you're not there.
And they're talking.
And Meredith started that shit. She said, how dare this bitch, she know I'm about to get married, put her mm-hmm. fucking disgusting ass, big ass, motherfucking, that shit looked like it came from Zales, okay? It looked like it came from Kiss. It's giving every kiss begins with K, even though it's big. Like, we can't see the flaws. Like, she didn't put it under a little microscope. It's probably got many little dirts and impurities in it. We don't even know. And Meredith's like, I should say something to her, but she knows she don't want to say something. Mm-hmm. And then she's like, well, Jenny,
can you
like, y'all please. Are closer than we are because we've had so much tension and like you're the one who's like the closest to everyone. Jenny's giving messy Libra energy. She's giving Nene Leakes. She's mm-hmm. giving Christine from Selling Sunset where she's like, oh, we need to blow some shit up. Oh, I got you. No
I'll
problem.
Blow it up. Exactly.
But I'll be so nice, and she'll know that it's coming from a good place. 2 weeks before somebody's wedding, and you tell people that you got engaged, that is not an infringement on their wedding. You know what is an infringement on someone's wedding? Is if that motherfucker had proposed to you at the reception.
At their wedding.
Then, yes let's toss hands. Let's throw hands. Like yes. Tony Romo. Let's throw hands, okay? I think that is so tacky. I know people are like, oh yeah, weddings, like propose. Don't propose at my
wedding. Disgusting.
But for someone to tell you that they got engaged, you're just mad because you were shitting on her at the bachelorette party, and then she got to be like, nana, nana, boo, boo, my ring's bigger than you, boo.
Uh-huh.
And you're mad. And they're all mad, because that's why Jenny agreed to do this shit. Because she was like, oh, well, that ring bigger than my ring, too, and my man is in debt. I didn't even realize till we got married that he had so much financial aid to go to the school that we went to. I'm over here paying off his loans. My parents put down the down payment on our house. Jenny mad.
It gets worse.
Oh, no. No, it doesn't. No,
she gets another text.
Not another text.
Along the same exact lines.
They
from
got a group
different
chat.
Bridesmaids.
They got a group chat.
Mm-hmm. So she's now got two texts of this length, different phrasing,
no.
Same message.
How did Meredith align all of the troops? These girls hated Meredith. And now all of a sudden she's Queen Bee. I'm confused.
It's like you have the one girl who's not married, who's like rich boyfriend is jetting her off for weekends places. She's clearly having more fun than you and your like three terrible children.
Yeah, so some of these women got married to get married. She ended up with the baller shot caller, and they're like, damn, we should have held out like this bitch did. And
yes.
We could have been
and
fucking
so now they need to knock her down.
Oh, so she's Queen Bee and she doesn't even know it. Amanda, you won.
She's got to get it together.
Oh,
what do
Amanda.
You do? Now we're at door number two. What
Amanda,
do you do?
Amanda, this is what you do, sis. I'm chaotic good. You don't even respond to the second bitch. And before you open the text message, you put your red receipts on. You open that text. You put your red receipts on. You know she saw you read it. You wait 3 hours so you know that she's checked the text and she'll see that it says seen at the bottom. Then you go into the group chat and you say, hey guys, I've received several. You've only received two, but we're going to say several because the bitches don't know. I've received several messages with deep concern about me sharing my happiness with you all overshadowing Meredith's wedding. And I just want to say that that is something that I would never do. I believe that we can all be happy for each other. I never would take attention away from beautiful Meredith and her amazing day. I would quote Meredith. I'd be like, on Meredith's first date, she told me that her fiance said that they were meant to be. And I think that their story is so beautiful. And I cannot wait to champion it with you all. I will be there. I will be supportive. And I would never, never even think of trying to steal a moment from her, and nor could I, because it is her day and she is a beautiful queen. And you know, and I would fully put the onus on them. I'd be like, wow, I'm just trying to be happy and y'all mad. That's the subtext of that. Wow, I'm happy and y'all mad. Okay, don't worry.
So you had chosen chaotic good. Amanda goes chaotic evil.
Ooh.
She texts the first girl back. She says, and I quote, I will not be discussing any of this with you. It is disrespectful to me and to Jake to even ask this of me. If Meredith wants to discuss this with me, she can text me herself. And then she blocks both girls who texted her.
Blocked?
Blocked
them?
Blocked. Gone.
Amanda. Now, you done dug yourself into a hole. That's not how you play these games. That's not how you play these games. You
but
know
she's
these
mad.
Games. Yeah, but she should have sat down in a corner or called her cousin or her sister or her mama, you know, anybody other than these friends and got your... You don't... This is another tip, guys. When someone does something or says something that pisses you off, you don't respond immediately because you're going to put yourself in the losing position. Because when you get upset, people know they got something out of you. Or they feel vindicated or right about attacking you, especially if they're crazy enough to send you these types of text messages. You call your homegirl outside of this group and you cuss and you yell. You're like, these raggedy bitches, I can't believe I supported them when we were pleasure and we paid all this money. Fuck that handkerchief. I can't wait till I get it. I'm going to throw that shit in the fucking fire. Fuck these hoes. Like, you know what I mean? You'd be like, Madison got wide hips. Like, you go off. You go off to somebody.
You open the fire hydrant to someone not involved.
Outside. Then you go back to the message and you give them back what they gave you. Because people don't know how to deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
And you come back as a gracious queen. You come back, and this is the only time I would tell you to play victimhood and just be like, and don't play victimhood too strong. I think it's more just like, hey, I've received several messages. I just want to assure everyone that we can all be happy and that my happiness is not a detraction from your happiness. And I will fully stand beside you and uplift you and make sure that you have the best day because it is your day, queen.
Special day.
Mm-hmm. And I would have left it at that. That's how you put your foot on all those bitches' necks. And then what are they going to say? You the one with the big ring and you the gracious queen. But instead, you over here popping off on people. And now they have some tea to take back to that 14-person group chat.
Yes. So as you can imagine, the 15-person group chat is now silent.
Because they're 14.
Because they're in the 14 text. We're 2 weeks before the wedding. She gets one text from, ostensibly from Jenny, but sent by another bridesmaid that's like, I don't know why you're making me the bad guy. She ignores that, thank God. But she's getting no information, right? She's like, the group text is no longer working.
She isolated
the wedding's
herself.
In 2 weeks. She's been iced out. She's like, fuck them. I'm announcing my engagement publicly.
So now you're doing what they told you not to do. And now they feel like they're right about the bullshit that they gave you. Oh, she's...
Every single person in the wedding party likes the post, but does not text her.
Amanda, you need to learn how to play chess.
She is not playing 3D chess. This girl's playing checkers. She's so bad at it. And this is where I'm like, girl, you need better friends, right? Like, I'm like, this is all a mess that you could have avoided by just bailing.
She doesn't deserve better friends. She needs to go to therapy before she gets better friends. She is the most oblivious, self-centered narcissist, and she's a punk on top of that. You can't be all of that.
You got to pick one. Really.
If you're going to be a narcissist, at least have hands. Like, you can't, you can't be a punk ass and then want to be mad. Like,
Amanda has just written this into now it's the week before the wedding. Okay. And, you know, this is the kind of, like, rich sorority southern wedding where it's like Thursday night drinks, mm-hmm. Friday night rehearsal,
it's an event, a weekend event.
It's a whole weekend, right? Saturday wedding, Sunday brunch. It's Tuesday and Amanda has heard nothing.
Oh, Amanda, girl, they don't invite you.
Full radio silence. What do you do?
Okay, you have two choices. And it depends on what mood I'm in and if I've had a glass of wine or three.
Yes.
So right-minded me, don't go to this wedding. And also, don't invite any of these hoes to your wedding. Also, unfollow them on all social platforms.
Just delete them.
And just be like, this is done. This was college. I'm grown now. Let it the fuck go. I'm going to give you three options here. Second option, chaotic me. Hit the group chat up. No, you know what? No. Second option, chaotic evil me. Call Meredith. Don't even do a group text. Hey, Meredith, like, what's going on? Uh-huh. Like, you know, a lot of people have reached out to me expressing, and I would do this, which is so fucked up. I'd be like, and I would name them. I'd be like, Jenny. And Rachel and Madison texted me saying that you were upset that I got engaged and that you felt like I was trying to upstage your wedding. Like, I would erase their subtext, and I would go mm-hmm. straight for their real text and be like, I can't believe they would do that to you. Like, why are they causing drama on your special day?
On your special day.
Because I was just sharing my exciting news, but I had no intentions of trying to overshadow your wedding. I could never.
Not.
You and I were the closest. You told me that y'all were soulmates on the first date, and I was supporting you. So why do you have these women in your life who are spreading vicious gossip so close to your special day? I don't like that for you. I'm mad at them for you, queen. And then if you really want to be just fucking batshit,
door number three,
group chat. Hey y'all, did y'all make another group chat? Because I see that nobody's been talking in this one. Are y'all mad at me because I said that I was getting engaged? I wasn't trying to upstage the wedding, but several of y'all have texted me saying that you thought as such and that you thought my ring was too big and that I'm a bitch. I sprinkle in some shit for a little dazzle. Like, and y'all call me a bitch. And I was like, I'm y'all's friend, and we've been friends for so long, and this really just hurts me so much. Do y'all hate me now? Like, what's going on? Like, are y'all mad at me because I got engaged? I'm so sorry that I shared it with you. I guess I should have kept it to myself, but I thought we were all friends. But if y'all don't want to text back and y'all don't want me at the wedding, I completely understand, because I shouldn't have shared my happiness with people I thought were my closest friends.
Okay, you're way too good at understanding other people and what they might like and how they will respond. Amanda is not like this.
She's not.
She doesn't, all of those are great options. They all have different consequences, but they're all really good options. What Amanda does is she texts Meredith, text, first mistake, as we've been over.
Call her.
This bitch texts, and she's like, I just haven't heard anything. Like, I don't, she does kind of try to do the emotional manipulation where she's like, you know, I thought that you were so happy for me. And like, I didn't understand what has happened here. She's making it about her.
Huge flaw.
And she's like, so I don't even know, like, I want to be there on your special day, but I don't even know if you want me there.
Okay. And why would you open the door for a question why? That you don't want the answer to? Because obviously, yes. If she's got you on ghost mode, if she has if she's gone full Casper, if she's gone full who you gonna call, then you already know the answer to that. Don't leave no room. Go get what you want and make it about her. That's what
she
people
can't.
Don't understand.
She can't. Meredith texts her back and is like, "Of course I want you there. In fact, it's the least you can do." What's her reasoning? Do you have a guess?
Absolutely. She was mad about the big ring. Mm-hmm. She was mad about Amanda's happiness, and to a richer man than whoever the fuck Meredith decided to have a shotgun wedding with. And she was like, it's the least you could do, trying to be like, yeah, I told them bitches to tell you what they said, and I meant it. And now bring your ass over here, and I want you to be mad at my wedding, but hiding it because you have pride. I want you to be mad, and I want you to be quiet.
The reason that Meredith gives her, the least you can do is come, otherwise the sides will be uneven. The bridesmaids and the groomsmen. What do you do? The wedding, you've got to go to all these events, theoretically. Are you going? This is the last time I'm going to ask you. We're closing in on the end.
Since you're having a lopsided wedding.
You're not going.
No, and also, I'm going to do something real petty the night before your wedding on all social platforms, just so I can make sure you're real upset. I might even do it from a burner account. I might even, this is me. This is me if I'm going to
be sliding into the groom's DMs.
Yep. This is me if I'm being toxic. If I'm being toxic because you're toxic, and I don't live in the realm of toxicity, but I can play. So, if we're, like, Amanda, if you really want to be toxic as fuck, make a burner. Put a man's face on it.
Yep.
Damn her husband. On all platforms. And also leave several comments on his pages. Wow. You're fucking my girlfriend. I guess she's everybody's girlfriend. And put that shit up at like 2 a.m. before the wedding. That way you know he's asleep, knocked out, drunk. And then he goes see it in the morning.
And she's going to see it.
And make sure you follow Amanda on the page. Follow several other people. And also get online and buy fake followers. And post so enough photos that the page looks legit.
These are all great ideas for someone who has any ability to think about other people or the way that they might behave. This is not what Amanda does. Amanda goes to the wedding.
Amanda, why?
And as you can imagine, as you correctly predicted, Meredith ignores her the whole time and is like, you're here to do my, like, bidding. The other bridesmaids will talk to you. I don't need to talk to you. And as the final nail in her coffin, which you guessed earlier, she embroiders those fucking initials over the whole empty space on the handkerchief.
Listen, Amanda, if you were smart, if you had a petty bone in your body, you'd have been like, oh, I'll find a place in the handkerchief for myself. And then you would have took the handkerchief and you would have burnt that shit in your fireplace. Mm-hmm. And been like, oh my God, the handkerchief burnt down in the fire.
Oopsie.
No worries. I made a new one and it's all evenly spaced. Here you all go.
Mm-hmm. These are all great strategies. Amanda does not do them. But to her credit, she is like, you know what? I don't think these people are my friends anymore.
It took her this long.
I know. And what we have heard from our friends of her friends is that the wedding was 8 months ago. She has not spoken to them since. None of them are in her wedding. And the ties are fully severed.
Mm. Amanda, I feel like you could have got some revenge out of this. Tell them they're all in the wedding.
I feel like it's still not too late.
I'm like, tell them they're all in your wedding. Send them the link to buy the bridesmaid's dress. Make it a little too expensive. Just a little too expensive. Not too expensive that people will cause a fuss, but just like a little too expensive for a bridesmaid dress. Just a tad. Just a tad. Let them invest. And then you tell them, I'm not having a bachelor party. You have it. You take all the photos and videos. You tell everybody they can't post till a certain time. Tell them to take your phones. Mm-hmm. Take your phones. Right? Have a videographer. Then you invite them to a wedding that is not at the right address. Or the right day. And you have them show up in those expensive dresses.
Actually, and then while,
tell them the
and
wedding
then while
is while
they're
at your bachelorette party.
That's what I was going
to
say.
So they show up to the wedding and then you start posting just photos at Tulum with your real homies. Because you ain't going to be friends with them anyway, so you might as well leave them a little bit broke, a little bit mad. And you block them all. They can't contact you on any platform.
They're gone. They're dead to you. Well, I mean, that's the end of our gossip. Lacey, thank you so much for coming on.
This was a blast. Oh, so fun.
Where can our listeners find you?
Oh, guys, if you like mess and you like scams and comedy, Scam Goddess Podcast on all platforms. You can find me on socials at DivaLaci on all socials except for TikTok, where I'm Laci Mosley. And iCarly, first season is streaming on Paramount Plus right now. Next season will be out soon. And the second season of A Black Lady Sketch Show, if you like comedy, is out on HBO Max, all episodes.
Thank you so much for coming on, Lacey.
Thank you for having me, Kelsey.
Thanks for listening to Normal Gossip. If you disagree with our takes or have a gossip story to share, please email us at normalgossip@defector.com. Or you can leave us a voicemail at 2679-GOSSIP. But please be aware that the voicemail box cuts you off at 3 minutes. So you can also send us a voice memo at our email, normalgossip@defector.com, if you need to go longer. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at @McKinneyKelsey. You can follow the podcast on both at @NormalGossip. This podcast was produced by Alex Sujong Laughlin. Thank you to Projects Editor Justin Ellis and Editor-in-Chief Tom Lay and the rest of the Defector staff. Defector Media is a collectively owned, subscriber-based media company. If you love this podcast and want to support us, subscribe to Defector at defector.com. Thanks to Kelly for sharing this excellent gossip story with us. I'm Kelsey McKinney, and remember, you did not hear this from me.